map of Eastern Europe. That was at the heart of National Socialism was a racial revolution, a demographic revolution in which they were going to remake the entire population, particularly of Eastern Europe, on Nazi principles, and that Jews were going to disappear from this area one way or another, and that initially this was seen through driving them out. They were going to be just driven out of Europe and sent somewhere else. It turns out, as the Nazis found in their experiments, that in this case it was easier to kill people than to expel them. And when they faced the complications of expulsion, that didn't work. That is what then led to the two stages I will talk about of the mass murder, in which expulsion, ethnic cleansing is given up, and a policy of systematic and total mass murder is adopted. This is the key transformation I want to look at. When did this vision of a Nazi Lebensraum in the East, free of Jews through expulsion, get replaced by a vision of a Eastern European Nazi empire free of Jews through systematic and total mass murder take place? Now, much of this then leads to a issue of what some have called the dating game. What date did this tipping point occur? And there's been some frustration among people that scholars like myself are quibbling over this month or this week in the year 1941 or early 1942 in comparison to the vast number of victims, of 6 million dead. Why does it matter that this took place in October or December of 41 or April, May of 1942? Who cares? It is that question I first want to discuss. Why is this important? Why do we care about pinning down just how these decisions played out and how the final solution became a policy the Nazis adopted and tried to implement? One reason is that as a historian, I simply like to get the record straight. Part of what we do as historians is try to be factually accurate, to know as much as we can about what happened before we can begin to work on interpretations of why things happened. There's nothing quite so frustrating as a snazzy theory about why something happened. What you're explaining is not what happened, and that the cart has been put before the horse. So simply getting the factual basis right is part of what historians do. It's the beginning of what we do, not the end, but it is a fundamental, foundational activity that we're engaged in. A second factor, of course, in this particular case is that there are those that do not wish us well. David Irving, in making his argument about Hitler's innocence in all of this, was, of course, at that point, a Hitler apologist. As I'll talk in my fourth lecture, he comes a Hitler, a Holocaust denier, but that was a subsequent development. Initially, he was not denying the Holocaust, but he was denying Hitler's role in it. And he was quite willing to distort the facts, as Deborah Lipstadt had argued, to arrive at that motivated distortion of history. In this particular case, then, it is not just a matter of historical curiosity, but it is a matter of fending off those who are trying to intentionally distort the record. And here, again, it is important to get the record right. I do not wish to make their enterprise any easier. In fact, I want to make that enterprise as difficult as possible. And the way to do that is for historians to do their job carefully, irrefutably. And in this particular case, since for the deniers, pinning down Hitler's role is central to them. The argument that we don't have the written order, we don't have the black and white evidence of Hitler doing this at a single point in time, requires us to explain how it did happen to the best of our ability. I think a third reason is that it helps to restore a sense of contingency. All too often, events in history, once they have happened, are accepted as kind of inevitable. We now explain why they happened, and the tendency is to say, well, they had to happen that way. If we want to restore contingency and therefore moral responsibility, it is important to restore the points at which things could have been done differently and which decisions to the opposite could have been taken. Understanding the decision-making process, documenting it, helps us to establish, in effect, that the Holocaust is a man-made event. The Holocaust was not a natural disaster. It was not a tsunami. It was not an earthquake. It was something that human beings did to other human beings because they decided to act in certain ways. And understanding the decision-making process, again, I think is very, very crucial to that. And finally, in terms of the question why, I will argue tonight that over the course of 1941, the historical context changed very rapidly. That what the case was for how the Nazis saw their position in Europe, say, in the summer of 41 is very different than in October of 41, which is very different from December of 41. That these may be periods very close together. But nonetheless, the historical context of each of those dates is very, very different, and thus to understand the context within which the decision was taken, crucial for understanding why, you have to get the date right. And therefore, focusing on dating is not arcane. It is not a scholastic enterprise, but in fact, very fundamental for trying to understand the wider context in which the Nazi program of genocide of the European Jews emerged and was attempted. Okay, that's sort of why I've been involved in this.